Let us pray. Creator God, on this great day of celebration, we give thanks for the rich inheritance we have enjoyed in this university, for the wisdom and encouragement of those who have opened our minds, challenged our perceptions, and enriched our learning, and for family and friends who have supported us and who share in celebrating our achievements this day. Bless those who journey forth from here to their different places and countries of work. May they use their newfound wisdom and skill for the relief of suffering and the conquest of disease. May they use their gifts of compassion and understanding to bring health and healing to those in need, building up the health care of all humanity. We give thanks for all our graduates. May they find great happiness in all that they do, and may they go forth with a spirit of courage and compassion to meet whatever lies ahead. Amen.
Thank you, Chaplain. Please be seated. Good afternoon to you all, and welcome to this afternoon's graduation ceremony, the last of the week's graduation ceremony, but not the least, because we have dentists and doctors, or there will be dentists and doctors. It's such a grand sight to see you all here, the families, the friends, relatives, and you're all most warmly welcome. Before I ask the principal to give you an address, I want to say something very special. You'll all be graduating soon, and you'll be very proud of it. We, the university, are very proud that our principal was awarded a knighthood in the recent birthday honors list by Her Majesty the Queen. And we'd like to congratulate you again. And that's his graduation over.
Thank you, Chancellor, and thank you all for those warm congratulatory words and applause, which is greatly appreciated. I hope it's something that is celebrated throughout the university, because it is the university and its own success that is really being acknowledged. Chancellor, Deputy Lord Provost, graduands, honorary graduand, ladies and gentlemen, let me add my a very warm welcome to those of the Chancellor, to all of you here who are graduating, and all your family and friends who are in the audience. And for those of you who are visiting Dundee for the first time, I'd like to extend a warm welcome on behalf of the city and the University of Dundee. We are now, of course, a UNESCO City of Design, a status we share with Beijing, Berlin, and Buenos Aires, amongst others. That title was accorded to Dundee at the beginning of the year and is a great sign and symbol of our emergence as a global city. And I'm proud to say that the university is at the heart of these changes. We have a close relationship with the city, which goes beyond education to the sharing of knowledge and the building of partnerships, which have brought great economic prosperity and cultural prosperity to our city. And that relationship with the city, which is very important to me personally, as well as to the university as a whole, is symbolized in our graduation ceremonies by the presence of today, the Deputy Lord Provost Christina Roberts, and for yesterday's ceremonies, the Lord Provost himself, Bob Duncan, was here. And there is always a presence from our city council leaders here in these ceremonies. So could you please give a warm round of applause to the council. So, returning to the subject of my address, As a university, we're a founding partner of the V&A Museum of Design, Dundee, which is now beginning to take shape on the waterfront, with a hub of a biotechnology sector which now accounts for 16% of the local economy. And we aim to be a key part of this city's future as a centre for renewable energy, promoting the sustainable use of global resources. Our strong and effective relationship with the National Health Service in Tayside and Fife consistently produces benefits for patients, not least those with diseases such as diabetes. None other than Sir Mark Walpert, the UK government's chief scientific advisor, said of the city's contribution to diabetes care and prevention, "If you live in Dundee and suffer from diabetes, you have been participating in a medical revolution." The ethos underpinning these activities is encapsulated in our core mission as a university: to transform lives, locally and globally, by the creation, sharing, and application of knowledge. The work we do here at Dundee has applications and implications for people around the world, not restricted to Scotland or the United Kingdom. And it's my privilege as principal of this university to see much of this work firsthand and witness the impact it is having here in Dundee and around the world. To illustrate this, I'm going to share with you examples of our most recent work and its positive effects from here in Dundee, literally to the other side of the world. Just recently, I received a rare visitor in my office. And you might think it strange that one of our staff, Professor Tony Martin, is rarely seen in Dundee. But that's because, as Professor of Animal Conservation, he has spent much of the last 3 years on the island of South Georgia in the Southern Ocean. South Georgia is a unique environment that supports an abundance of marine and terrestrial wildlife. Its population of seabirds was under threat of extinction from the presence of millions of rats, which were introduced to the island while it was a prime whaling station. Our habitat restoration project is a huge effort to save those native birds from extinction, increasing their numbers by millions and restoring the island to its status as one of the most important seabird sanctuaries in the world. Tony and his team have now completed the job of clearing all the rats from the island, which means the native flora, fauna, and animal life of this fragile ecosystem can flourish once more. The challenges of this project have been immense. South Georgia has been the largest rodent eradication project the world has ever seen. And it seems remarkable to me that a university in the northeast of Scotland, of modest size, has achieved such a feat of logistics and prodigious effort, literally on the other side of the globe. More locally, around the same time, we welcomed hundreds of schoolchildren in Dundee to the university for the culmination of projects they have been working on to redesign the city's waterfront using the computer game Minecraft. The level of engagement with the project they displayed was remarkable. Primary 6 and Primary 7 children have been thinking about how their city could look, and they are the future generations of this city of design, expressing their own creativity. I look forward to seeing whether the city planners take forward their ideas for a Dundee Eye or an underwater restaurant. And I'll be the first to book a seat and a table at that restaurant when it opens sometime in the future. And then just last week, we unveiled a research breakthrough that could change the lives of people across the developing world. A new compound created here in Dundee that may not only offer a treatment for malaria, but also protect against future infection. That's been made possible by the gathering at the University of world-leading expertise in drug discovery. And we created our drug discovery unit to help meet the need for new drugs to treat what are termed neglected diseases. A drug that eradicates malaria would change the lives of millions of people every year. And that is what we mean when we say our mission is to transform lives. It's a mission that applies equally to our students and to our graduates here today. I hope each of you have experienced transformation through your time at Dundee, that you leave here equipped to face your own future challenges and achieve your ambitions. Each of you can have a significant impact on lives in Dundee, across the UK, and around the world, delivering tangible economic, social, and cultural benefits wherever you choose to work and to live. Our students are also a vital part of the community here on campus, one which has representatives from 145 different countries. We are immensely proud that our students have voted Dundee the best student experience in Scotland for the past 6 years, and consistently among the best in the UK. And now, as graduates of Dundee, I hope you'll become our ambassadors to the world. We have a goal through our transformation agenda to become Scotland's leading university. We're already leading, not just in the UK, but internationally, in much of the work we do. Our reputation as a centre of excellence can only help you in your future lives, and I hope you will continue to watch and stay connected with us as the university goes from strength to strength. 2017 will see us celebrating our 50th anniversary, when I hope to welcome many of you and some of our 80,000 other alumni back to the city and the university campus. In the meantime, I wish you all well for the future and hope you will continue in your association with the university, taking pride in its success, as I will undoubtedly take pride in the achievements of each and every one of you. Thank you.
Thank you, Sir Pete. Now, before we start the conferment ceremony for degrees, there's an important process or oath that is to be taken by all the graduates in dentistry and medicine. You might take this oath just once in your life, but that's the oath you will live and work by for all your working lives. And now it's my pleasure to ask Professor John Connell, Vice Principal and Head of the College of Medicine, Dentistry and Nursing, to administer the oath.
Chancellor, before the medical and dental graduates are presented, I will ask them to assent to a declaration that they will maintain traditional standards of professional conduct. Can I ask the dental and medical graduands to stand? The Chancellor has said, today's graduation is an important transition for all of you from undergraduate to postgraduate life, but also to entry into your chosen professions. And this declaration is a mark that you understand the importance of that transition. I will read the declaration and I will ask you to assent to it by saying, I do, at the end. I solemnly promise to use, to the best of my knowledge and ability, the art and science of my profession for the good of those under my care, and to make the preservation and restoration of their health my constant aim. I shall keep secret anything I see or hear in my practice that should not be divulged. I shall constantly endeavour to improve my knowledge and skills within my profession, and to share useful discoveries with my fellow practitioners, whom I promise to hold in fraternal regard. These things I shall do for the benefit of those whom I seek to serve and for the honour of the profession that I now join. Do you make this promise? Thank you.
My pleasure now to invite Dean of the School of Dentistry, Professor Mark Hector.
Chancellor, thank you. I have the honour of presenting to you for the degree of Bachelor of Dental Surgery. Marianne Dobson, Maria Tahaney, Hannah Agnew, Amar Alibi, Lahini Diva, Megan Broadley, Eliska Dvorakova, Christopher Fowles, Alistair Gilmore, Claire Gilsonen, Heather Lundbeck, Rebecca Manson, Rebecca Masterson, John McAlevey, Maeve McCann, Megan McMillan, Jennifer Miller, Stuart Milligan, Claire Murphy, David Murray, Sebastian Milchrist, Jennifer Sands, Simon Shannon, Patrick Steed, Jennifer Tanzilli, Neha Thummel Penta, Kirsten Walker, Andrew Wilson, Amir Abd Aziz, Bashar Abu Al-Souf, Muhammad Abu Bakar, Mawa Al-Burushi, Adnan Ali, Fatima Anwar, Rachel Burgess, Dara Byrne, Michael Byrne, Aoife Cannon, Grace Conway, Rachel Dack, Louise Flavelle, Carly Fraser, Aidan Hannah, Benjamin Hastings, Elaine Hogan, Alexandra Holden, Laura Kelly, Aaron Lang, Michaela Lafferty, Victoria Lawson, Joshua Lowe, Kamal Maddock, Aoife McCohen, Nurul Mohammed Salemi, Norfatia Mood Yatim, Isra Mujahid, Salam Proti, Faye Rice, Mariam Rizwan, Catriona Ross, Jaideep Sangera, Nirmal Shah, Rory Stewart, Ryan Stewart, Emma Summers, and Stephanie Wiseman. And for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Oral Health Sciences, Sarah Cunningham, Anthony Galloway, Sophie Godsman, Ashley Hughes, Sophie Marr, Hannah Rennie, Lindsay Keane, Stephanie Keith, and for the degree of Master of Dental Science, Eslam Enjabawi, Nafisa Qureshi. For the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, Anas Ali Abraham, Munir Atassi, Christine Hansen. And Fiona Stewart.
He's probably wondering why I'm holding him up.
Yes.
Because some of you know he is the holder of white gloves. An award that has not been given for the last 11 years. The rest are puzzled as to what this is all about. It's an award that the students give when the whole class passes all the exams at the first sitting. And that hasn't happened since 2004. And this man and his staff have made it happen. That's why the students give him white gloves with a class photograph that is framed. So congratulations. Thank you. On the other hand, think of all those dentists. Hold on to your teeth. Now, it's a great pleasure to welcome the new dean of the medical school, Professor Gary Myers, to present the medical school.
Chancellor, I have the honour to present for the degree of Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Surgery with honours, Mary Brown. Amy Bryan. Roisin Convery. Roisin Donnelly. Claire Fugaccia. Catherine Gardner.
Why I held her up too, didn't you? She won this year's Sir James Black Prize for her research. Sir James Black was my immediate predecessor, Chancellor of this university. He was also a Nobel Prize winner in medicine. So you don't have a difficult task to follow. But congratulations on your prize, and congratulations today.
Riada McCready. Joanne Smith. Amy Taylor. And with commendation, Rachel Hammond. Jamie Ingram. Una McIntosh. Alice McLaughlin. Rosanna Thompson. And for the degree of Bachelor of Medicine and Bachelor of Surgery, Simon Aitken. Lara Armstrong. Rusha Ashur. Harjinder Baines. Shraddha Bagani. Roslyn Black. Livia Bowden. Joanna Breen. Amy Brogan. Andrew Brown. Colin Cairns. Claudia Cameron. Emily Chan. Helena Charles. Sui Yun Cheng. Laura Clapham. Caitlin Collins. Diane Collins. Siobhan Connolly. Neil Craig. Rebecca Crook. Callum Cunningham. Rebecca Cunningham. Heather Curry. William Darasha Gulter. Peter Darling. Kieran Deneath. Andrew Devine. Sean Dolan. Ian Donald. Thomas Downs. Baron Dreyer. Lucy Drinkwater. Kenneth Duffy. Poppy Edwards. Zara El Waled. Derek Elliott. Ruri Ellison. Lauren Firth. Yasmin Flatt. Alan Geddes. Joseph Gamey. Miles Gilpin. Sarah Gishkori. Emily Gray. Hannah Lee Gray. Lawn Green. Thomas Greensmith. Jennifer Gruer. Adam Griffard. Caitlin Hamill. Nicholas Heath. Hannah Humphreys. Stuart Irvin. Anna Jameson. Rebecca Johnson. Yasmin Karachiwala. Lucy Kays. Bernard Kearney. David Kelly. Marie Curie. David Keeley. Jane Kilkenny. Suzanne Kilpatrick. Maeve Kinsella. Pamela Knudsen. Jennifer Kyle. Chu Jun Lim. Yun Yi Lin. Nathan Litley. Katrina McCauley. Carrie Mackay. Katrina McCrae. Karen Marshall. Jennifer McBrien. Hannah McCorkin. Claire McCall. Lucy McClymont. Michael McCormick. Michael McGovern. Ryan McHenry. Andrew McElrath. Isla McInnes. Paul McKenzie. Jordan McVeigh. Gur Mohan Singh. Caroline Morrison. Anna Mowbray. Manveer Multani. Elspeth Murray. Kirsten Murray.
Stand up. Now, Kirsten, this is a bit of fun. So I hope you take it as fun. Do you recognize anybody else here? Quite a lot. He delivered you.
I know.
Also won the prize in obstetrics. He's a professor of obstetrics. I'm a rather dated professor of obstetrics. So now you know in 15 years where you will be. Is that a promise?
Okay.
Congratulations, well done.
Lakshmi Nayar. Guad Shiung. Johannes Nussmann. Aoife Ní Cúinní Ní Cheev. Satoko Orihashni. Stacey Orr. Heather Osborne. Thomas Attaway. Pallavi Patel. Andrew Peace. Suvi Pereira. Katie Pettigrew. Fiona Ramsey. Jennifer Reed. Paige Ringsell. Lydia Robb. Megan Robertson. Mark Rogerson. David Royan. Rachel Russell. Adil Shafi. Catriona Shenton. Karen Sims. Jenna Simpson. Kirsty Smith. Kirsty Snedden. Adam Snowden. Yung Hui Su. David Soto. Neil Stevenson. Kaylin Taggart. Sarah Taghizadeh. Vanushia Thurimal. Anna Marie Tia. Leo Urquhart. Kavita Valland. Eleanor Belton. Robert Walker. Catherine Wallace. Kirsty Ward. Amy Watson. Kenneth Watson. Hin Wong. Jonathan Wright. Alexandra Young. Helena Young. And for the degree of Bachelor of Medical Science with honours of the first class, Connor Aldworth. Siobhan Chien. Marie Clark. David Claxton. Marie de Saint-Croix. Matthew Donaghy. Luke Dornan. Christopher Fong. Janie Girardon. David Gorman. Amy Hudson. Hilary James. Holly Lamont. Lucy Littlejohn. Duncan Lockie. David Peter Lynch. Kirsty McNeil. Mary Therese Monaghan. Connor Nickel. Yvedzo Ntuli. Michael Overend. Jennifer Pate. Claire Pearson. Sorcha Ring. James Robertson. Katie Ross. Lauren Ross. Jessica Thompson. Zach Thompson. Helen Toner. Ruth Trimble. Nicola Trotter. Jonathan West. And with honours of the second class upper division, Kerry Adrian. Erica Bates. Helen Boyd. Kieran Boyle. Daniel Dolan. Rhoda Downey. Louise Fagan. Victoria Gilchrist. Nicole George Lambrakos. Robin Idle. Judith Lee. Gabrielle Meyer Costa. Christina Manson. Carlos Martini. Kennedy McCaig. Aoife McCloskey. Laura McGuigan. Hannah Miller. Yvonne Milne. Brian Dielwyn. Lewis Robertson. Emily Rooney. Gordon Russell. Joshua Rudniger. Ian Swan. Woo! and with honours of the Second Class Lower Division, Ross McCord. And for the degree of Bachelor of Science in Medical Science, Jack Bruce. For the Postgraduate Certificate in Medical Education, Feltz Fombong. Colin Hall. Adbimp Mataluko. Gemma Redmond. And for the Postgraduate Diploma in Medical Education, Gillian Hamilton. And for the degree of Master in Medical Education with distinction, Kabir Dewani. Laura Farrell. And for the Master of Medical Education, Mario Bugaggi. Nazima Idris. Marwa Schumann. And for the degree of Master of Orthopaedic Surgery, Gaurav Bhandari. Calvin Matthias. Pradyumna Raval. Chaoming Zhao. And for the Master of Public Health, Fina Amarojo. Shamaz Asna. Paul Henry. David McLaren. Josephine Murray. Eleftheria Vasileu. Zuan Zhong. And for the degree of Master of Science with distinction, Sarah Bergen. Hope Plastock. Jade Scowcroft. And for the Master of Science, Dalla Al-Zafiri. Pamela Burney. Sarah Brooks. Diona Chan. Caroline Finley. Thomas Gilpin. Linda Halley. Orla Hall. Lucy Irvin. Kaylee Jameson. Jennifer Kerr. Luis Larea Murillo. Fiona McConnell. Morgan McDonald. Hannah McRobbie. Julia McVane. Siobhan O'Hagan. Gianni Sakathevan. Chancellor, I have the honour to present for the degree of Doctor of Medicine, Arpit Jarawala. Aaron Ramanathan. Chancellor, I have the honour to present for the degree of Doctor of Philosophy, Naveed Akbar. Karen Barton. Deirdre Cassidy. John Findlay. Lizzie Gordon. Nicola Grant. Elizabeth Haythorne. Vikash Hedge. Evstratios Kokelis. Gillian Libby. Daniel Morales. Louise Riley. Lynn Urquhart. And finally, Chancellor, I have the honour to present for the degree of Master of Forensic Medicine, Yo Er Yong.
Thank you, Professor Myers. Principal.
Chancellor, I have the honour to invite you to confer their degrees in absence upon the candidates who have been unable to attend this ceremony.
By the authority of the Senate, I confer these degrees.
One of the things that's very special about degree ceremonies here in Dundee, apart from the Chancellor every now and then getting up and intercepting graduates coming across the stage, is the way that we combine the sort of pomp and circumstance and ceremony with a sense of joy and celebration. And we want to focus very much on the latter in the next couple of minutes. Now, you actually have a very special responsibility because this is the last degree ceremony of the summer, and therefore you have to send us off with a really big bang. Now, what's required for this is decibels, not decorum. It's not about polite applause. It's about cheers, whistling, stamping of feet, and generally making as much noise with the help of all the audience, including the babies, as much noise as it's possible to do. So, without further ado, congratulations to all of you.
Are you done? How can you as doctors and dentists scream and shout so much? Thank you for that, and well done. You can cheer them. Professor Connell, do you really want to do this?
Chancellor, I have the honour to present for the Chancellor's Award for his contribution to teaching my friend and colleague and the Dean of Medicine, Professor Gary Myers.
Professor Myers, as Chancellor, it's a great pleasure to confer upon you the Chancellor's Award for your continued and enormous contribution to teaching.
Thank you.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Hang on. Now he doesn't know what I'm going to say. Because I taught him. So I'm really, it's great pleasure to see you taking it further. Congratulations, and I know how much you have worked hard for improving medical teaching and training in this medical school. Be proud of you, congratulations.
Thanks, Nick. Appreciate it.
It's now my pleasure to invite Professor Mike Ferguson to present the honorary graduate for the degree of Doctor of Laws.
Thank you. Chancellor, I have the honor to present for the degree of Doctor of Laws, honoris causa, Dr. Neil Buist. Those of us who study life sciences or medicine do so in the hope that we might have a positive impact on human health and well-being. Dr. Neil Buist, who came to study medicine at the University College Dundee in 1950, is a shining example of achieving such a positive medical impact. Throughout his career, Neil pushed the boundaries of metabolic medicine and established in Oregon the largest metabolic clinic in the United States, which, together with a wide network of regional clinics that he established as well, screened neonates for inborn errors of metabolism and treated many disorders and countless patients. Now, fortunately, most of you here, the medical and dental graduates, know exactly what I'm talking about when I say inborn errors of metabolism and metabolic medicine. Indeed, some of the medical faculty might even know what I'm talking about. Seems unlikely. says Professor John Connell. But I know that some of the parents and friends and siblings of the graduates may not know what inborn errors of metabolism and metabolic medicine are. So, in essence, the human body consumes food and converts the chemicals therein into our own molecular parts list that make up and maintain our blood, our brains, our muscle, and so on. For some people, a part of that complex machinery that does this metabolic origami goes wrong. And babies born with these defects often suffer terrible consequences with respect to their physical and mental development, frequently resulting in shortened lifespan and greatly diminished quality of life. Neil was a pioneer in the field of applying metabolite analysis and was able to pinpoint exactly where these babies' metabolic machinery was damaged, thus classifying for the first time many rare and not so rare genetic and metabolic disorders. In many cases, he was able to solve or greatly reduce the diseases by modifying the patient's diet. Further, through his biochemical acumen and broad network of scientific contacts, he was able to get many conditions more thoroughly researched and understood by other medical scientists. If I might quote Neil himself, he once said, "To some extent, I viewed myself as a clinical pimp whose job it was to detect interesting cases and then get them studied elsewhere in more depth than we could ever hope to in Oregon." My own view, and that of his peers, of this kind of modesty is that it's typical of his modus operandi, where he always ceaselessly worked to maximize patient benefit, something I think that we can all understand and that we're all grateful for when we receive it. To say that inborn errors of metabolism can be fixed by diet is a grossly oversimplifies the problem of those treatments. Neil recognized that the modified diet for a relatively common disease called phenylketonuria, for example, was not very palatable. Better said, it was absolutely disgusting. So he took the initiative and the time and the care to empirically score each of the 20 individual amino acids that make up the proteins of meat, milk, fish, and eggs, and so on, for taste and mouthfeel. And he did this by basically coercing everyone that passed by his clinic to take the Buist taste test. The result, though, was the Oregon mix that, up till today, transforms the lives of these patients. Now, as if all this was not enough, Neil also embarked on a secondary career in the 1980s when he responded to the humanitarian crisis when, in running from the killing fields, hundreds of thousands of Cambodian refugees fled across the Cambodia-Thailand border. Neil's ability to spot nutritional deficiencies in the refugee camps was key to saving many children and adults, both there and a few years later in the Sudan. Neil became de facto the expert in nutritional diseases and their impact on tropical infections, and he has trained many others through his lectures on the subject. He has also provided much needed on-the-ground expertise in Afghanistan, Ethiopia, Sri Lanka, El Salvador, and Somalia. Dr. Buist has been a great supporter of international pediatrics in other ways. For example, by establishing with his family the Buist Trust, that among other things, sponsors the Child Health International Partnership Program at our very own medical school. This fosters the education and training of overseas pediatricians, offering opportunities currently available to them in their own institutions. This kind of international training is key to improving medicine in the developing world. Medicine, at its best, is the fusion of the scientific with the practical and with deep compassion. Dr. Neil Buist has demonstrated these traits in spades throughout his professional career and through the Buist Trust. In short, the world is a better place for the difference that he has made. Chancellor, for his services to science, medicine, and the developing world, I have the great honor to invite you to confer upon Dr. Neil Buist the degree of Doctor of Laws.
By the authority of the Senate, I confer upon you the degree of Doctor of Laws. Congratulations.
Thank
and
you,
welcome. Sir. Please stand up.
Can I go here?
In a minute. I can't resist saying stories when you try to teach me pediatrics, Neil. As a medical student, I should have paid more attention.
Of course.
It's a pleasure to have you here, and congratulations.
And it's a pleasure to see that you graduated. It's hard to recognize yourself in an accolade such as that, but I am from a family of Dundeeadonians, have been here for a couple of hundred years, and in spite of the fact that I'm an expat and over in America, I feel deeply honored by what our university has given to me today. I am convinced, of course, that this is undeserved, and in fact, when I told a cousin of the honor, he said, "Bloody hell! You can't be serious." Anyway, I was being serious. And 60 years ago, I sat where you're sitting. And I think I know now what you folks are thinking. I wish that fellow would sit down and shut up so we can get back out to the pub. But before I do that, I have a message for you that comes from 450 years ago, from William Harvey, hymn of the circulation of the blood. And it runs like this. Nature nowhere more openly displays her secret mysteries than in cases where she shows traces of her working apart from the common path. Nor is there any better way to advance the proper study of medicine than by careful examination of the rarer forms of disease. For it has been shown in almost all things that what they contain of practical or useful in nature may scarcely be discerned unless we are deprived of them in some way. And that is exactly the message that we have from the inborn errors of metabolism. You don't know that anything's wrong until it's happened. I've had, as you heard, the fortune to work with these patients in scores of different rare diseases. For these rare diseases occur in every practice. Like it or not, there will be examples of rare disorders, maybe not metabolic, but rare conditions in your practices. And it will be your duty, and only by curiosity and perseverance will you be able to unmask these mysteries that bedevil your own practice. Your basic training probably in no way will have you equipped to unmask these problems, but your training as scientists and as physicians should have equipped you for this task. Without the recurrent stimulation of these interesting oddities of medicine, these rare cases that you're offered, you, I think, are in mortal danger of sinking into a repetitive morass of complacency, exacerbated by the dark undergrowth of mind-boggling bureaucracy of the NHS and the comforts of an expanding midriff. So never give up the search for an explanation in your patients. To do so diminishes your standing as a physician and diminishes the chance that that patient will have a better life. Thank you.
Can I please ask you to come with me here? I have to do this because he runs away otherwise. But he writes all the songs over the whole week of graduations we have, and the wonderful choir sings it. And he's the one who plays the organ. And we're very grateful that you do this, and it's wonderful music. So thank you very much. If I hadn't done this now, you'd have rushed away up there. So choir, please stand and take an applause now. They are fantastic, aren't they? Please be upstanding. I declare this academic ceremony closed.